तत्परं पर्याय विद्महे ज्ञानलिङ्गेश्वराय धीमहि तन्नो गुरुः प्रचोदयात्। ओम ओम योग महर्षि डॉक्टर स्वामी गीतानंद गिरि गुरु महाराज की जय। The Savitri Pranayama, a foundational practice of the Gitananda, and why I emphasize the term the Gitananda tradition is because when we talk about yoga in modern times, we are faced with great difficulty. The difficulty of talking about yoga in modern times is yoga has become anything that anyone wants it to be. So when you have something like yoga that has become anything that anyone wants it to be, and you say you are sharing yoga, you can often get into trouble. In fact, most of the time when I'm traveling the world, and while I'm traveling, a fellow traveler asks me, what do I do? Usually I prefer to just say I'm a medical doctor, because they have some idea what a medical doctor does. If by chance I happen to say I teach yoga, or I'm a yoga teacher, or anything like that, it's like opening the Pandora's box. All sort of misconceptions are there. All sort of confusions, prejudiced, preconceived notions. And so when we are using the term yoga, in modern times, we are forced to qualify it with a prefix or a suffix so that people understand what exactly we are doing. If I were to just say I'm teaching yoga, there's so much of confusion out there that at least when I say this is the yoga practices, the concepts as per the Gitananda yoga tradition, what I do is I give a context for the practices. Because without a context, we are in very big trouble. Swamiji would not really like this. And many of his senior students have often criticized me. I won't really call it criticism, because it comes from a place of love. It comes from a place of, you know, respect and gratitude and a feeling that I have been misguided and they need to guide me. So, you know, I don't take it really as criticism in that way, because it comes out of something else, another better place, much better place. And one of the criticisms that does come is that your father would not have liked you calling it Gitananda Yoga. And I say, yes, most probably my father would have kicked me in the butt, because that's what he used to do when he didn't like what people were doing. They got a good kick in the rear. And it's actually a good idea. When you kick somebody in the back, you help them move forward. You have to be careful of the people who kick you in the front, because they are pushing you back. So those who kick you in the back are actually helping you propel. They're giving you some more momentum to move forward. So nothing wrong about that. And I say, yes. But I say, you know, the time period my father was living and teaching is different than the time period today. And hence, in those days, you did not have to give a context to yoga. You could say, I'm teaching yoga, and at least there was a very general understanding that yoga was something which was spiritual, that yoga was something emotional. And it was not limited or mutated the way it is mutated today. So hence, given the change in circumstances, we are having to use that term as Gitananda Yoga, or as I prefer to use it, in the Gitananda Yoga tradition. Rather than put a label on it, the teachings of the Gitananda Yoga tradition, which then put the tradition in the back and the yoga in the front. Yoga should always be our priority. Which form of yoga, whose yoga, should always be in the back, not the other way. Once my father was asked, he said, someone said, what type of yoga do you teach? Because it had started this branding of yoga. I like to tell people, rather than branding of yoga, we need to practice generic yoga. Generic yoga is actually what we need to work with, is yoga as it is, without sounding fanatical. And my father was asked, Swami Gitananda, what type of yoga do you teach? And he said, well, yoga is yoga is yoga is yoga. There's no suffix, no prefix. So yoga is yoga is yoga is yoga. They said, yes, but you know, there's so much of yoga out there. How, what is it that you teach? How would you term it? And he said, well, if I had to give it a name, I would say Rishi culture. Because the yoga tradition, as we understand it and live it, is something that has been handed down thousands of years by the grand masters, the rishis, the ones who had the highest perception and perspective and were able to codify the system with that vision. They were the visionaries. A rishi means one who sees. We all have eyes, but do we see? The rishis were visionaries. They could envision what the humanity needed and give the teachings appropriately. So he said, I would call it Rishi culture because it comes out of the culture that has been expounded by the great rishis. Later on, in around 1999-2000, that's about now 20 years back, Ammaji added a little bit to it because Rishi culture was still a bit vague. So Ammaji added to it by saying Rishi culture Ashtanga Yoga. The term Ashtanga Yoga came in because these teachings are based on a foundation of Maharishi Patanjali's Ashtanga Yoga principles. So the principles, the philosophy, the psychology and the practice of Patanjali's perspective of yoga, the yoga darshana, are foundational to this system. And so Ammaji, when we had the millennium meet in 2000, she tweaked it a bit from Rishi culture, just Rishi culture, to Rishi culture Ashtanga Yoga. So it is the Ashtanga Yoga of Patanjali in the context of the great rishis and their teachings that is being then passed on. Now, we used it for some time and even now we use it. But then the problem came. Every time you say Rishi culture Ashtanga Yoga, you now have three explaining jobs to do. Actually, four. What is Rishi? You have to explain to people. What is culture? You have to explain to people. What is Ashtanga? You have to explain to people because they get confused. And what is yoga? You have to explain. So now you have to explain four things instead of one. So it becomes even more difficult. And that is why some years later, we felt that the term Gitananda Yoga could be used as a tool of identification, not limitation. So the Gitananda Yoga term is for identification, not to limit the teachings. Because the teachings are limitless. The teachings cannot be put in a box. And so the term Gitananda Yoga, or sometimes you'll find me using it as Rishikulture Ashtanga in brackets Gitananda Yoga. Now you have 5 things to explain. And that is why more recently I'm just saying the teachings in the Gitananda tradition, which sort of puts it into the context. What is this Gitananda tradition? See, the Rishikulture is definitely Kanakananda and his teachings. But Swamiji brought a new element into it. And this morning I woke up to an email from a very dear student in South Africa. And she was talking about how the speciality is how the modern scientific perspective and the traditional perspective are both brought together in a seamless manner, in a sense of integration and integrity in the Gitananda tradition. So it is not that it's a pure scientific, it's not that we are talking about when you do Paschimottanasana, your gluteal maximus and your lumbricals, and you know it's not this modern approach, which is a bit too reductionist for me. So it's not that. And it's not this absolute traditional that you have to go by each word in the scripture, otherwise you are cursed to go to hell. So it's not that extreme, it's not this extreme, it's the middle path. And for me, that is what yoga is all about. It's the middle path. It's the path where both the extremes come together. In that spectrum, you don't want to be on the extremes because both the extremes pull you apart. Both the extremes take you off the path. Both extremes push you off balance. And that is why it doesn't lie in the extremes. The answer doesn't lie in the extremes. The answer lies in the middle path. And this is why for me, every time we try to understand any of the concepts of yoga or the practices, we need to look at the traditional perspective and the modern perspective and find where they come together. That meeting point. You know, Mark Twain made a statement. He said, the East is East and the West is West and the twain shall never meet. No, that is Kipling, sorry. Yeah. No, because it says twain, I get confused. Rudyard Kipling, who wrote the Jungle Book, the original Jungle Book. He said, the East is East and the West is West and the twain shall never meet. Well, the twain have met. They meet in the Gitananda tradition of yoga because you have the Eastern traditional philosophy and you have the Western modern approach. And they come together in a seamless way without dichotomy. And that is why in this tradition, when I talk about the Gitananda tradition, for me, it is not about my father's teachings or claiming ownership. It is about enabling people to understand that if you want to hit water, you need to dig your well deep. If you want to mine diamonds, you have to go very, 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 very deep in one place. Most people nowadays are puddle diggers. They just dig a little here, a little there, a little this. In Tamil, we say, Nai vandhu saapadla vai vekkra maadhiri. What happens is that dog doesn't go and finish the meal. If there are 10 plates, it goes and takes a little of all the 10 plates and doesn't finish any plate. It's a common metaphor given in Tamil. Nai saapadla vai vekkra maadhiri. It just keeps the mouth. And taste it, doesn't complete it. You have to be very careful because being a puddle digger will never enable us to hit water, hit oil, or hit gold or diamonds. And the depth that is within us is more priceless than anything else. It is the most invaluable treasure. The nidhi that lies within us, that treasure that lies within us. Dravinam Twameva Vichan. That Dravinam, that treasure that lies within us, is more valuable than anything else. So coming back to What we have been working on, we have been working on the Savitri Pranayama, a foundational practice of the Gitananda tradition. And we have seen how the different kalas are enabling different manifestations to occur. How do these manifestations occur? Why is it 2-1-2-1? As Arvind Swami asked me yesterday, why is it 2-1-2-1? Well, it is a password, it is a key word, it is a key number. And all of these ratios, all of these numbers are based on hitting a certain part of our subconscious, unconscious, or consciousness. And in order to open the window or the door into that dimension, certain combinations are used. And that is why it is not the same all the time. When you do the Sukha Pranayama is 1:1. You breathe in for the same count as you breathe out. When you do the Sukha Purvaka, the four part, you have the Loma, where you breathe in, you hold in, breathe out, 1-1-1. Or Viloma, you breathe in, breathe out and hold out, 1-1-1. Or the Sukha Purvaka, you breathe in 1, hold 1, out 1, breathe out 1. There's a certain pattern that is there. Because that is the pattern, when you repeat it with your breathing, you start to open the window or the door to that consciousness of that experience. It is a keyword, the password, for that meeting to occur. Nowadays with Zoom, everybody is putting a password. You have to have the number of that meeting, you have to enter the password to get into that meeting. This is like that. Same. When we do the 2-1-2-1, the Savitri experience opens up to us. That life-enriching experience opens up to us. So that is why it is 2-1-2-1. And then each one, when it is 4-2, when it is 6-3, based on that combination, a certain aspect of that opens up even more. Even more it opens up. That is a very, very key element that we need to understand. Because what is happening, people ask questions not because they want answers, just because they want to ask a question. It's a major problem as a teacher. Is you have to know whether the person is asking a question for the sake of finding an answer, or asking a question because they want to ask a question. There are many people in classes like that. They just want to ask a question. And that is very often, when you find that, you find people who, whatever you say, they say, why? Every time you say, this is what is happening, why? That is what is happening, why? This is what you need to do, why? And there's so much of why, that finally the only answer to that is, why not? The greatest answer to the question, why, is why not? It changes the perspective a lot. Coming back. The Savitri, in all its grandeur, opens up to us when we are practicing it. So, when you do each of the practices, and this morning I did about 3,500 steps because I cannot go out cycling with all these restrictions. So, I said, okay, I'll walk on the roof. And I said, okay, what pattern do I try this morning for my walk? And I did a 10-5. Usually I do a 6-3 or an 8-4, and I did a 10-5. And I tell you, it is absolutely different. It is absolutely different. The 10-5 pattern when you do a walk is absolutely different. What it does to your whole pattern of walking, try it out. Don't take my word for anything. As Swamiji would say, he say, don't believe anything because I say it. Experience it. But initially you have to take it in. Now what happens with people is, when you say don't believe anything I say, they say, okay, I don't believe you. And they stop there. Dealing with difficult students. I think a special class is required on that. You say don't believe anything I say, experience it. They say, okay, I don't believe you. And they stop there. What it means is that, listen to me, take it in. Take it in, practice it and see whether this is the experience you have. The rishis have said this is the experience they had. The teacher can say, this is the experience I have had. But you are the one who has to have your own experience. And if you want that experience, you have to do it. How will that experience happen if you don't do it? And this is why Indian culture valued experience, because experience is something you cannot buy. You cannot have somebody else experience it for you. You have to experience it for yourself, which means you have to do what is required for that experience. You want to bake a cake, for God's sake, you have to go through the steps of baking a cake, and then presto, that cake will appear. If you do nothing, no cake appears. And if you do the steps that make instant noodles, you are not going to get a cake. You get the experience for which you have done the steps. You do the steps for instant noodles, you're going to get instant noodles, whether you like it or not. You will not get a cake. You do the steps for a cake, you get the cake, not instant noodles, whether you like it or not. And just because you are you, it's not going to change. It's not going to change. I am me. Yeah, okay, fine. If you do the steps to make instant noodles, you are going to get instant noodles, whether you like it or not, and it doesn't matter who you are. The same thing with these practices. You have to do the practices and have the experience. Yoga is experiential. See, the difference between the modern approach and the traditional yoga approach is, the modern approach is experimentation. We are always experimenting on somebody else. Or something else. We are always experimenting externally. Yoga is an experiential journey, which means it is internal. So if you want to understand yoga as an experiment, it is an experiment of the self with the self for the sake of the self. Yoga is an experiment done by the self with the self for the sake of the self. It is all an experiment, but with the self, not with somebody else, not with something else, not something that is externalized. And that is why the whole experimental journey, which is the modern medical and scientific journey, is a journey based on the senses, whereas the internal journey is one based on intuition. Now people say, okay, I'm going to do that internal journey. So I will not do the external. Yeah, but how do you know you are doing anything? You could be goofing it up. Patanjali has understood that he has such type of students also. I think one of the first online courses I will start is the Yoga Sutra, because the problem is how to limit it. And it may go on for 196 hours because I need 1 hour for each sutra by the time I get through them. And that's just so much that nobody will join me. Because in 200 hours, you can be a goddamn yoga teacher. So why should you do 196 hours of Yoga Sutra with Dr. Ananda and not become the great grand master of yoga? Anyway, we'll work that out later. Patanjali is very clear, because he has seen all type of students in his time itself. He says, there are the antarayas, the obstacles in yoga sadhana. And one of the obstacles is called Bhranti Darshana. Bhranti Darshana means a false sense of that you have attained something. It's an illusionary attainment of a certain state. Darshana means to have a vision. Bhranti is illusion. I like to joke that it's like the illusions that people see when they have a peg of brandy. Brandy Darshana is what most people are having. They get drunk and they see a lot of stuff. Most people are smoked on stuff that way. Bhranti Darshana is a major issue. And that is why if my father would be very clear. My father was very practical man. People would say, you know, I am so elevated. I am so spiritual, Swamiji. I am so very, very spiritual. You say, wonderful. He said, if in day-to-day life, you do not have a simple awareness of the people around you, if you do not have a simple awareness of what's happening around you, how the hell, and sorry for that, that belongs to Gangsta Yogi, not Dr. Ananda. But my father used to use that. Yeah, he was a Swami who sweared. Okay. He was a sailor. Okay. He had a big tattoo on his arm also. So sailor language, you know what that is. He said, if it doesn't percolate into your day-to-day life, this is all an illusion. And there are people walking around who think they are spiritually so elevated. And they are not. They are suffering delusional psychosis. Delusional psychosis, Vranti Darshan. If that spirituality doesn't come into your day-to-day life, if it doesn't make you a better person, if it doesn't enable you to be more compassionate and understanding of others, if it doesn't make you more alert to what needs to be done and do it, what use is that? It is not escapism. People treat spirituality as escapism. It is not escapism. The first step in yoga is responsibility. Taking responsibility for yourself. Responsibility for your thought, your word, and your action. Becoming an integrated human being. One who has integrity. That is what a yogi is. When we are doing these practices, the experience that comes from within is your personal experience. That has arisen out of your own sadhana. And no two people are going to have the same experience. It may be similar. You know, I remember a person coming up to me once after a talk, and he's like, Dr. Ananda, when you close your eyes, do you see the light? I said, I like to keep my eyes open and see the people around me and what I can do for them. Close your eyes and see the light. That was his idea of spirituality. For me, it is open your eyes and see what you need to do for those around you. Put into action these concepts. Eyes wide open. Heart wide open. Hands there to help. That is spirituality in action. So when we are doing the Savitri Pranayama, each of these patterns is enabling an experience to unfold from within. It is like a beautiful flower that is opening up. And you know, when the sun comes, the lotus opens up. The sunflower opens up. This looks more like a crocodile opening its mouth. This is a crocodile in dance. This is a flower. This is a good lotus opening up. This is a crocodile. Be careful of these guys. It is this. When the light comes, the flower opens up. Similarly, our experience opens up when we practice and the light starts to glow. This is not just true for the Savitri, it's true for all practices. Gitan, what did you experience on the 10-5 breathing when you walked today? One, it made me go faster because the five thala is a dynamism, and I could feel that dynamism surge through me as I added the 10-5 to my walk today compared to the 8-4 and the 6-3. Yes, Bernadette, you'll see the light when you meet a crocodile for sure. Hopefully you see the light. Adi Shankara You know his story. He saw the light when the crocodile caught hold of him, because the crocodile caught hold of Adi Shankara as a young kid in the water. And that was the time he asked his mother, he said, I want to become a sannyasi. She was not allowing him, because you, in those days and now also, if you, you know what happened? If you wanted to become a sannyasi, if you want to take sannyas, you had to get your mother's permission if you were unmarried and your wife's permission if you were married. Now, some people will say, which wife? You know, that's a problem there. So I'm not going down that. Adi Shankara was asking his mother. She didn't give permission. And so one day the crocodile catches hold of Adi Shankara. And he, you know, this guy, instead of saying, help me, he asks his mother who's standing on the bank, Mom, at least let me become a sannyasin now. And she's like, this guy's going to die anyway. Okay, so be it. And he gets permission and the crocodile goes away. Coming back. The 10-5, Gargi is asking the question. She says, you know, maybe slower. Actually, it may be faster. And that is why the experience can be different for each person. Normally, what I used to use a lot was the 6-3. What I found with the 8-4 was it sort of made it more like a march past. But with the 10-5, I found a dynamism today. So just to give you an answer, it doesn't mean you have to have the same. Each one of us has it in a different way. But next time we meet, I wanted to take it forward that how the Savitri Pranayama is utilized in our Jnana Yoga and Raja Yoga Kriyas and Prakriyas of the Gitananda tradition. So let's meet again whenever we meet next time, and see you all. Be blessed. Hari Om Tat Sat.